actually not damage to the nervous system, but instead poor sitting posture.
Did you know that those who sit with their backs off the chair are proven to live 10 years longer?
When you sit with the back on a chair, you're actually compressing the discs in your spinal cord, which hinders blood circulation throughout your body.
We told a group of our friends this, and the results? Most of them sat up straight like all of you had, while 5 of them even vowed to ditch chairs completely.
Hi everyone, I'm Sissy.
And I'm Team Jen. And we just made all of that up.
You see, all it takes is a few words to make an entire audience believe in something. Today we'll be discussing the power of words and its ability to impact one's perception and culture.
So, what is the first thing you think of when you see this picture? What do you think the person on the right is saying to the person on the left?
Hands up if you think it's something negative. What if something positive? This picture can actually be interpreted in two very different ways, and it all depends on the words that you choose to caption it.
We like to define words as a superpower in which we already possess.
If you were to choose between having the power of invisibility and the power and the strength of Hercules, which one would you choose?
Well, actually, words have the ability to give you both of those powers. It has the ability to make one feel invisible, but also the power to make one feel stronger.
Words are like keys. They can open the doors, but they can also lock you.
So it's ultimately up to us to decide how we want to utilize this key. Now, let's talk about media in all of this. So everyone knows that the media depicts false stereotypes of people by photoshopping bodies.
The reason is that people often hate on photos that aren't photoshopped or photos that contain body images that don't have ideal body
images. As more people come in negative words on photos like these, the society begins to implement the idea that everyone has to be skinny to fit in and to be beautiful. But besides the words and messages that the media tells us, a lot of times the harshest words are the ones from ourselves, but are still the ones that we choose to listen to. For example, I grew up as a very, very skinny child. My brother was always called the strong one, and I was always called the skinny one. People always meant to call me skinny as a compliment, but at the same time, they were reinforcing the idea that I have to be skinny to be liked and to feel worthy. As I grew older, family members didn't call me skinny as much, but at school, it was still a standard I had to live up to. For example, changing rooms, I often overhear people say that they are too fat.
How many of you have heard of that in our locker rooms?
Okay, quite a few. And although I have never experienced what it's like to be overweight, I was always really self-conscious of my body. So soon enough, I started to starve myself, exercise more, and I didn't realize the damage I was doing to my body, as I always believed that everyone around me were also on diets.
This is a standard image that we have collectively created, and it turns out that this is a common issue found in modern student body.
So from this survey that we conducted, we can conclude that every other student at our school also feel overweight, and that 83% of students are not only discontent with their body, but also feel the need to change it. This includes feeling the need to get stronger, grow taller, etc.
So maybe instead of telling themselves that they need to fulfill the unrealistic expectations of a skinny body, Hinton and the girls in the locker room could have looked in a mirror and told themselves that there's no need to compare themselves.
Instead of trying to fit into these unrealistic beauty standards, we could have just been content with ourselves. For example, instead of only complimenting each other when someone has fit into these standards, we could celebrate our differences without labeling any body type as better.
So we've talked a lot about the power of words just now, and now I'm going to talk about the opposite of that, which is the power of silence. According to our survey, more than 77% of the people who took it reported that they have felt inferior to someone else in their school before. During my 7 years at TAS, I've actually never witnessed physical bullying or physical violence before, but this survey tells us that there are things that are way stronger than physical actions and can cause someone to feel insecure around certain people in our school. The story that I'm about to share with you is an example of how a single word can cheer down a bully. Describe Push her away, she would order one of her friends, whenever I pass through the territory. And she would tell everyone in the class, ignore her, or you will be ignored too. But using her popularity, she threatened everyone in our class and made them follow her orders. For a period of time, I had no friends, no one to sit with, no one to talk to. And there were some people in her class who were neutral. These people did not bully me, but they did not reach out to stop the bullying.
See, using her words, the bully was able to turn the entire class against Sissy. She used her superpower in a negative way that made her feel even less confident than she already was.
But what I did not realize back then was that she did not own the power. It was her friends and her classmates who gave her those powers by not speaking up against her. The power of silence is just as influential as the power of words.
Now, enough of our personal stories. Let's talk about the things that take place here around us every day. From a survey we sent out, we opened up discussion to words that are commonly misused here at the school. So here are some direct quotes from the survey. Now, most of you look pretty uncomfortable, and that's for a good reason. These words are offensive, and we have to censor a lot of them out just because they are so inappropriate. But why are we still using these words?
Maybe it's because they represent humanity.
Yeah, students don't tend to use these words with their teachers, but they do so comfortably with their peers and classmates. A reason students use these words is because they don't have the social context. People use offensive terms because they aren't surrounded by people who are offended by them.
And there are individuals who talk about these words very casually without even thinking about the implications behind the words. So Starbucks is known for writing their customers' names on their cups. And a friend of mine from the US once went to a Starbucks store in Taiwan. And when he got his drink, he noticed that instead of writing his name on the cup, they wrote whiteboard, means boring. The Starbucks employees obviously did this for convenience and easy recognition. But at the same time, they drew a border between my friend and everyone else here by implying that he's different and unable to fit in. Now, most of you probably think that's not really a big deal. Maybe it isn't. But as more people use these words on a daily basis, categorizing humans by race becomes a habit of many, and some words regarding race.
Similar to other mindless use of words and rhetoric, clothing company H&M has created an offensive advertisement that unintentionally discriminates against the Black community. And this all happened last week. As seen here, this Black child is wearing a shirt that says, "Coolest monkey in the jungle." This ad unintentionally insinuates that Black people are associated with monkeys, a racist implication that incited much controversy in Johannesburg, where many H&M stores were trashed and raided. So here are three more terms that students submitted to our survey.
So the difference between this slide and the previous slide is that the words on the previous slides are words that are obviously inappropriate, meaning that everyone knew the negative meanings behind the words, and that everyone knew that you're not supposed to use them.
But a lot of these words are used, and people don't realize how wrong and offensive they could be.
For example, one question that students in TAS often ask is, "What did you get on that test?" And when students ask these questions out of curiosity, it's a normal thing to do. But sometimes, when students ask these questions for the sake of competition, they're actually undermining certain people's worth and importance. Because they discuss grades in a competitive way, they're defining the people who don't have high GPAs as the losers. This increases the amount of peer pressure among TAS students.
So the next time you hear a peer or a student label someone else, you can reason with them with some historical context. For example, you could tell them
that when you use the word retard to insult someone, you actually insult the people with intellectual disabilities.
Or that the phrase "kill myself," also known as KMI, is actually offensive to people who are suicidal. And you never know who's listening to your conversation or just what other people could be going through.
Another more careful of the words that we choose to say, but there are always the little ones that are watching us and trying to imitate what we say. Tingjun and I would like to bring light to words that are being tossed around in the world.
The only way for there to be equality in this community is if we were to continually correct those who use these languages.
We hope that through our personal stories and our words, we have changed our perceptions of the power of words.
Words are like keys. Thus, really think about which doors you really want to open. Thank you.